To my people doing time. Exhibit juvenile. Y'all need to
wake up, everybody.
Nature. Gyro. Reptile.
Look, I'm inhumane, living in this house of pain. Stuck with 1,000 street hustlers down on their luck. Repeat felons, recorded with the death I was selling. And for the past 3 months, knew I could still hear my victims yelling. But I can't listen to my conscience, it's nonsense. If I didn't shoot, I'd be the Indian in the suit, in the box under the ground. Fox chased by the hound, locked permanent frown. Exhibit get down by lifting iron by the pound. For the tough individual, run and run his mouth, throw some hands with the general. Walk one day in the shoes of a criminal, death, disease, keep your luxuries to a minimal. I'm not talking about weed, jewels, and Bentleys. I'm talking about...
You're trying to build a prison.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the Thomas FreeMe TV and Podcast Show. First and foremost, I want to apologize for the delay in these episodes with Tanawah and I and some of the other episodes. I have several that I need to get out, but as I've explained in prior episodes, this is just me doing this, and I've reached a pretty rough stretch where I had to get out and just put this stuff to the side for a little bit and get caught up on my bills, things of that nature. This is my passion, and until it starts producing to where I can set aside some of these other tasks that I have to do in order to get these bills paid, that's just what I have to do. So I greatly appreciate the patience that my supporters and listeners have. I love you for it, and I will continue to try to bring the best message that I can, you know, produce the best documentaries, messages, discussions that only Thomas FreeMe seems to be able to bring. So, with Tanawah, his situation is somewhat likewise. You know, he's got a lot of issues going on in his life, and you know, we're both ping pong at each other. You know, when he's ready to go, I'm not ready. And when I'm ready to go, he's not ready. So it's just kind of being able to meet up. And today, fortunately enough, we have been able to do that. Today's discussion is going to be on Barron versus Baltimore. You've heard this case. It's a U.S. Supreme Court decision. And you've heard this case cited many times throughout the discussions with Tanawah and I over the last few weeks. And I'm going to read you exactly what Barron versus Baltimore is, what this decision is. So Barron versus Baltimore was decided in 1833. The Supreme Court ruled that the Constitution's Bill of Rights restricts only the powers of the federal government and not those of the state governments. The case began with a lawsuit filed by John Barron against the city of Baltimore, claiming that the city had deprived him of his property in violation of the Fifth Amendment, which provides that the government may not take private property without just compensation. He alleged that the city ruined his busy wharf in Baltimore Harbor by depositing around the wharf sand and earth cleared from a road construction project that made the waters around the wharf too shallow to dock most vessels. The state court found that the city had unconstitutionally deprived Barron of private property and awarded him $4,500 in damages to be paid by the city in compensation. An appellate court then reversed this award. Barron appealed to the Supreme Court, which reviewed the case in 1833. The Supreme Court, in a decision written by Chief Justice John Marshall, ruled that Barron had no claim against the state under the Bill of Rights because the Bill of Rights does not apply to the states. The court asserted that the Constitution was created by the people of the United States to apply only to the government that the Constitution had created, the federal government, and not for the government of the individual states. The separate states had drafted constitutions only to apply to themselves, limiting the actions of only state governments. Thus, the Fifth Amendment must be understood as restricting the power of the general government, not as applicable to the states. The court argued that the validity of this conclusion is bolstered by the fact that the Constitution nowhere states that the Bill of Rights also limits the actions of state governments. Thus, the state of Maryland, through the actions of the city of Baltimore, did not infringe on the Constitution. With no federal claim, the Supreme Court thus lacked jurisdiction to hear Barron's case and dismissed it. Good morning, good sir. Perfect time.
Good morning. Good morning.
I think you're still on mute.
I'm muted. Good. How are you?
I have no sound from you.
You have no sound?
It might be me. Hold on. It might be me. Okay. It might be me. Okay, let me hear you.
Okay, can you hear me now?
I can hear you. It was me.
All right. Yeah, I'm doing good. Doing good. Gonna fly out today and meet some people in Michigan, and I think we're about to start seeing some stuff happen here real soon. And I'm hopeful that I think that you know, there's a lot of people that I think are working for God and don't even realize it. And I see a lot of it happening. Everything's, you know, working for the good right now, even the bad. So yeah, what you just read with Barron versus Baltimore, you know, to think that the Supreme Court of the United States could come up with that sort of a ruling is just, it's fundamentally flawed. I mean, when they say that nowhere within the Constitution does it impair or restrict the states, of course it does. You know, I mean, Article 4 says the citizens in each state shall be entitled to all privileges and immunities as the citizens in the several states. You know, so, you know, the whole point of the Constitution was to bind a whole bunch of regional governments together into one single government. You know, we have 50 regional governments, state governments that are all needing to be one. And in order to do that, we have to have a set of laws that will unite us together. You know, so when we talk about America, the only thing that makes America America is American laws, nothing more than that. So, you know, when they say that nowhere in the Constitution does it say that, Article 6 also says that the judges in every state shall be bound thereby anything in the Constitution or laws of any states contrary notwithstanding. You know, so it does address it. It addresses it multiple times. It was obvious that the intended purpose of the states were to act as a neutral, unbiased judge. And that's supported by Thomas Jefferson's definition of federalism. So,
well, let me ask, who is John Marshall? Who appointed him? What was his party affiliation and such?
So, yeah, so that's a good question. Between one second here, look, I'm looking. So between 1862 and 1882, this is a separate period of time. There were 14 justices that were raised to the United States Supreme Court. Every one, except for Chief Justice Harlan, did not support any sort of individual civil rights individual liberty. They were all in support of business and business interests. And we can see that from their rulings that were put into place. There's another very interesting point, and that's that, just one second, let me find it here. Go ahead.
Well, the reason why I ask is because I would like my listeners, you know, perception and viewpoints to come from the manner of where the times were and what was going on around, you know, is, you know, and it's kind of like just what's going on today with the nominees of the Supreme Court justices that's being nominated and all the politics and power moves behind that. And I'm pretty safe to assume, I think, that same structure was being applied back then as well. You know, these moves that were being put, these power moves that were being made to put representatives in place that was going to go along with certain agendas.
Absolutely. Yeah. And we saw that all through the Gilded Age with the senators. You know, senators right. were appointed were elected by the state congresses and not by the people. And that had to change because they were being bought out by businessmen. And so we were seeing during the beginning of our country, we saw a lot of acts of deprivation of rights. I mean, we've never really been free. Our country's never actually experienced the things that we were promised. And that's unfortunate because, you know, I think that our laws, you know, allow for it, but it never happened. So Chief Justice Marshall, I don't know who appointed him, but I believe he was the second Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. The first was John Jay, who was one of the drafters of the Constitution. And so early on, you know, just like in the case of Chisholm versus Georgia, remember Chisholm was the one that said that there is no sovereignty of the states. You know, that was by individuals, justices who actually were involved in the drafting of the Constitution of the United States. So, you know, they believed in it. They wrote it. They, you know, they thought that it would work. And, but immediately after, you know, starting with that second court on, you know, we saw acts of that were fundamentally changing the Constitution. And this is a great example, you know, it's Barron versus Baltimore. And I know that Barron versus Baltimore, that they say that it was technically overruled by the 14th Amendment, but it wasn't. It was brought back in. And so we'll get to that in a moment. But, you know, our country's made many mistakes. I mean, we've made a lot of decisions that are based upon financial interests. And so we've got a long history of doing that and depriving certain groups of individuals, you know, equal status and equal rights because of our desire to advance business interests and money. You know, when we run our country as though it's a business, then obviously we're going to want to make money as a nation. And the way that nations make money is through the expense of the citizenry. So,
so the history on John Marshall is after losing to Jefferson in the tumultuous election of 1800, Adams nominated Marshall as Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court. He took office in early 1801, just weeks before Jefferson's inauguration. So that gives you kind of a mindset of who this guy, how he was appointed, when he was brought in. They use the word tumultuous election. So that's something I want to go back and look at and see what was so tumultuous about the election of 1800 and kind of give an idea of the social economics of that time.
Yeah. So Jefferson was, it was Jefferson, you said, right?
Jefferson was coming in. Yeah. After Adams, John Adams lost the election to Jefferson. Is when they appointed this guy, John Marshall, who made this Barron versus Baltimore ruling.
So we were having a split in parties. That was right around the time that we had the establishment of the two-party system. You know, Jefferson was the Democratic Republican Party, so he was kind of both. And then Adams was the old Federalist Party, which was much more conservative and built upon the central government rule. Jefferson actually, I'm not sure why he did it, but he moved away from support of the central government and went back to a localist view. You know, so like I said, there's when the Constitution was being drafted, there were actually two options that they were looking at. One was a localist view where they maintained sovereignty at the states and local power, more power at the local government and less power at central government. And thus it would be more like a democracy, right? You'd have sovereignty of the states. But like I said, we had those issues, the issues of no way to make the states implement the laws that we put into place, no executive officer to oversee it. Judicial authority to be able to make decisions that would impact all of the regional governments. You know, those were the three issues that we had. And that's why we have the three branches of government that were established, because each one of those questions were addressed by each one of the establishment of the three branches of government. So again, it was the localist view, which would be, you know, what Thomas Jefferson was moving toward. He thought that states needed to maintain their sovereignty, maintain the power, versus the central government being strong and powerful and being able to impose decisions that would impact all of the regional governments, which is really what federalism is all about. That's what our nation is all about. Because in order for us to be equal, we've got to have laws that would apply equally among all the people across all the governments. When you start having states that impose their own laws upon the people, then you have an unequal treatment of people. We don't have unity across our nation. That's more like the European Union than it is the United States of America. And so you know, I wanted to go into the actual letter, the actual legal argument that was submitted to the United States Supreme Court. It was actually submitted to the Ninth Circuit, but it was supposed to go to the Supreme Court. It actually took my case and remanded it to it because I think that it describes a lot of this, right? Certainly the bond. So if you don't mind, could I do that?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. And again, so when I took my case, I took it first to the district court, obviously. We prepared an argument. They turned it down and said, nope, you got to go back and argue with the states. I came back with a rebuttal, identifying the fact that they have a duty that's been established that they need to, then they need to make a decision on this case. And if they choose to not, then it would be misconduct. And I define misconduct. And they went ahead and dismissed it again. So now we have an intentional act of misconduct by a judge who's refusing to fulfill a duty, an obligation that's imposed upon him by statute. So then it went to the Ninth Circuit, and I showed them that, listen, you know, you guys, this district court, they made this decision, and it was under misconduct. And then I defined the way that the Ninth Circuit actually goes through the process to determine whether or not misconduct has occurred. And it's a two-part process. And the first part is did the judge apply the incorrect ruling or the incorrect rule? And he did, because he, or the wrong test. Because there's different types of judicial tests. The highest form of test is what's called the strict scrutiny, which is compelling state interest test. There must be a compelling reason for them to make this law legitimate. And that's called the compelling state interest test, and it applies for strict scrutiny. The lowest test is called just discretionary test, which means that the judge has the discretion to make a decision to do something or not do something. And so when it comes to fundamental constitutional rights, you have to employ strict scrutiny, you know, and you have to employ the compelling state interest test. So yes, he did absolutely apply the wrong test, because he used discretion to decide to deprive me of these rights. Now, the second one is an erroneous view of the law is an automatic abuse of discretion. And an erroneous view of law is the belief that a judge-made ruling, such as Hurtado versus California, can alter the provisions and guarantees of the Constitution of the United States. So that a judge-made ruling is, in legal contemplation, superior to the United States Constitution. That would be an erroneous view of the law, obviously, because the Constitution of the United States is superior. You wouldn't go with a ruling to make that decision. And so that's what this is all about. My case is actually going to Hurtado versus California, which that was with the Wake Court, and the Wake Court decided that the grand jury indictment clause 1 of Amendment 5 does not apply to states, and therefore the state of Washington can deprive me of the indictment by a grand jury. So the way that I'm going to be able to get to Barron versus Baltimore is, obviously, the state of Washington, the Hurtado case is direct progeny from Barron versus Baltimore. The reason why they do it is because of Barron versus Baltimore. So I will be able to attack Barron versus Baltimore through Hurtado because of the state's deprivation. And so that's what this letter is all about. It was a letter that remanded my case to the United States Supreme Court. It goes like this. The great philosopher Nietzsche once said, "Those who fight monsters should see to it that in the process they don't become a monster." There are two vastly opposing legal doctrines at work in America at this time. Our system of government is founded upon the government of laws doctrine, which is constitutionally based. It's built upon the theory that in order for laws to be legitimate, they must be considered just and equal. This is the egalitarianism approach, which our Constitution is framed upon. In order for all men to be equal, government and laws must first treat them equal. This is the way that our system is designed to work, based upon a fixed set of laws or principles in which the courts and people adhere to, and which every United States citizen is accustomed to. The opposite of the government of laws doctrine is the legal realism doctrine, which is very much alive and at work here in America, destroying our system of government and infringing on the rights of the people. Legal realism, of course, is the theory that law is not based upon a formal set of rules or principles, but instead upon judicial decisions deriving from their own social, political, or public policy. This is not constitutionally based, as it does not permit the fair and equal treatment of people. An excellent example of legal realism is the belief that a judge-made ruling such as Hurtado versus California can alter the provisions or guarantees of the United States Constitution. When one attempts to combat the doctrine of legal realism, they oftentimes utilize horrible judicial decisions such as Plessy versus Ferguson or Dred Scott versus Sanford, whereby the United States Supreme Court Chief Justice Taney stated in his dissenting opinion that blacks are not and were not intended to be included under the word citizen in the Constitution. Blacks are so far inferior that they have no rights which a white man is bound to respect. Slaves are private property protected by the Constitution. I don't think that there's a single United States citizen alive today who can help but feel shame and anger at those horrible words spoken by the highest member of the highest court in our land. There's no doubt that decision was made at a time of great conflict for our nation, and clearly bias and sympathy to the South. The alteration of the Constitution in order to perpetuate slavery is not approved by God and should never be supported by good men. What has happened, but to deny it would be a greater travesty. You see, a slave-based system cherishes ignorance. That's the only security for its oppression. Slavery is the mortal antagonist to our democratic institution. Truth is the only thing which people can be certain of. But truth doesn't cease to be truth simply because no one has the courage to speak up to defend it or because someone else disagrees with it. Truth is never dependent upon the consensus of opinion. If 1,000 people believe something to be foolish, yet one person knows it to be true, it is still true. Truth can never be made a lie any more than a lie can be made truth. The truth is that slavery, by any other name, is still slavery. Simply retitling it justice doesn't make it any less appalling. Changing it from a private institution to a state-run institution doesn't make it any more constitutionally acceptable. It is still slavery, and it is still a horrible injustice and wrong against humanity, regardless of what you call it or how you disguise it. While we're on the topic of truth, let's produce some more truth. In the case of Plessy versus Ferguson, there were 8 of the 9 United States Supreme Court justices who said that blacks are far inferior, that they have no rights which white men down follow. In this case, there was one single brave Supreme Court justice who dissented with the rest, stating, "Our Constitution is colorblind and neither knows nor tolerates classes among citizens. With respect to civil rights, all citizens are equal before the law." This brave patriot was Justice John Marshall Harlan, and this wasn't the only time that he found himself as a lone dissenter against every other justice on the United States Supreme Court. One other such instance was in the case of Hurtado versus California. You see, the truth is the same 8 of the 9 United States Supreme Court justices who said that slaves are private property protected by the Constitution also said the United States citizens are not protected by the provisions and guarantees of the Fifth Amendment. The truth is the same 8 of the 9 United States Supreme Court justices who said that blacks are not people also said that the United States Constitution is not supreme law of the land and does not enjoy legal superiority over conflicting provisions with state constitutions or laws. The truth is that the same 8 of the 9 United States Supreme Court justices who said that blacks are far inferior to white men also said that geographical discriminations are acceptable under our constitutional government. The truth is the same 8 of the 9 United States Supreme Court justices who said that blacks are not and were not intended to be included under the word citizen in the Constitution also said that states have the right to abridge the privileges and immunities of United States citizens. The truth is that the same 8 of the 9 United States Supreme Court justices who allowed their political interests to for the advancement of an industry to cloud their good judgment, also put into practice a ruling intended to advance that industry under a different name, overstepping the separation of powers and legislating from the bench in violation of the United States Constitution and the oaths of the offices in which they serve. George Washington voiced his concern about geographical discriminations in his farewell address, whereby he stated, "In contemplating the causes which may disturb our union, it occurs as a matter of serious concern for the characterizing of parties by geographical discriminations whence designing men may endeavor to excite a belief that there's a real difference of local interests and views. Foreseeing the potential for dissension here in America, Mr. Washington advised vigilance against the first dawning of every attempt to alienate any portion of our country from the rest or to enfeeble the sacred ties which now link together the various parts. The bonds which unite us as one people are origin, language, belief, and laws. These are the four great ties that hold our whole society together. The Constitution binds the American people to goals that are incompatible with slavery. President Abraham Lincoln said, it has long been a grave question whether any government, not too strong for liberties of its people, can be strong enough to maintain its own existence in great emergencies. United States Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall echoed this sentiment when he said, grave threats to liberty often come in times of urgency when constitutional rights seem too extravagant to endure. The strongest bond that holds our whole nation together is the faith in the laws between us. This is not the United States of Washington or the United States of California. I didn't serve my country in the military fighting for Texas or Alabama. I was defending America, as I am now and as I will continue until such time as God or death has relieved me of this obligation. It's time now for the courts to do the same. Here is some more truth. The truth is the United States citizens are governed by the laws of the United States. The truth is United States citizens are guaranteed the rights secured by the Constitution. The truth is that no person can be held to answer for capital or otherwise infamous crime unless on the presentment or indictment of a grand jury. The truth is that one brave Supreme Court justice did the right thing and stood for American principles despite fierce opposition at a time of great peril, and his sage wisdom can be trusted today. God bless Justice John Marshall Harlan. The truth is that United States citizens can believe and have faith in the United States Constitution because the truth can always be trusted to fight our battles. The truth can always defend itself as long as there's someone with the courage to speak it. The role of government is to govern, but that role to govern must be fair. Government ceases to govern when it chooses to take sides. It's no longer governing, but rather ruling. every citizen is entitled to fair and equal governing in the same way that every citizen is entitled to equal protection of laws. Thomas Jefferson voiced this to us when he said, bear in mind this sacred principle, that though the will of the majority is in all cases to prevail, that will to be rightful must be reasonable, that the minority possess their equal rights, to which equal laws must protect, and to violate would be oppression. To understand the rationale behind Article 3, Section 2 of the United States Constitution, which states, in all cases in which a state shall be party, the Supreme Court shall have original jurisdiction, we can turn to the author himself and the words he published in the Federalist Papers, Circular Number 10, New York Packet, November 23, 1787. The article was titled The Union as a Safeguard Against Domestic Faction and Insurrection. I have a little something going off here. In the article, James Madison stated, no man is allowed to be judge in his own cause, because his interest would no doubt bias his judgment and not improbably corrupt his integrity. With equal, nay, with greater reason, a body of men are unfit to be both judge and party at the same time. States cannot be, and were never intended to be, both judge and party at the same time because of the bias, prejudice, and partiality which would ultimately transpire as a result of it. States cannot be the accuser, or else innocence will suffer. So in the same way, and for the same reason why Tanawah Downing versus State of Washington in the current civil action is unconstitutional, so also is State of Washington versus Tanawah Downing in the original criminal action is unconstitutional. If 1 plus 2 equals 3 is unconstitutional, then obviously 2 plus 1 equals 3 is also unconstitutional. Simply rearranging the order of the parties does not magically change the representation of the parties. Article 3, Section 2 of the United States Constitution clearly states, in all cases in which a state shall be party, the Supreme Court shall have original jurisdiction. As a result, both Tanawah Downing versus State of Washington and State of Washington versus Tanawah Downing are unconstitutional and therefore illegal. And the only court with legal authority to adjudicate both matters is the court which had original jurisdiction in the case to begin with, which is the United States Supreme Court in accordance with the United States Constitution. Our forefathers who framed our Constitution were simple yet wise men. They weren't establishing complex principles or elaborate institutions that only men of rich or educated or noble statuses could understand. You see, they were simply trying to create a legal accounting system which adequately and fairly reconciled the debt owed to society. If you choose to violate the law, you incur debt that is owed to society, to which you're charged and then called to account so you can pay the debt. Now, these are all very simple accounting terms. Now, the way the debt normally works is, if I want to purchase something from a store, a bill will first be generated, which I sign and accept. Then my account is charged and I incur debt to which I then have to pay. This is a very simple method for transactions which anyone can understand. However, if the store charges a person's account without billing them first, that is called fraud. You must always bill before a charge is generated. How this applies to this case is that an indictment is called a bill. So absent an indictment, people are being charged fraudulently because they're not being billed first. Understanding this now, anyone who claims that a bill of indictment is not first needed before charging someone's account doesn't understand the basic principles and practices of a system in which they're dealing with. As a result of this very basic, fundamental element of our nation's legal accounting system being ignored, millions of United States citizens have incurred illegal and fraudulent debt. America must address this flaw in our nation's legal accounting system. In accordance with Rule 23 of the USCIS Rules of Civil Procedure, and in light of all the aforementioned evidence as well as the supporting evidence, petitioner asked the United States Supreme Court to authorize the application of the class action device in this habeas corpus proceeding. Included within Addendum 3, the court will receive the names of thousands of only a couple of the thousands of petitioners who filed a writ of habeas corpus pursuant to Title 28 U.S.C. 2254 between April 10th, 2019 and September 2019, whose cases raised the exact same allegations and were illegally and unconstitutionally dismissed by the United States District Court despite the jurisdictional error, and who are all now entitled to remanding the case to the United States Supreme Court for legal and constitutionally acceptable adjudication. The last point that I'd like to make is that every single thing I'm advocating is consistent with God's divine attributes. Release of prisoners, return of exiled captives, love in lieu of hate, compassion and not condemnation, forgiveness instead of vengeance, equity, not tyranny. I know what side I'm on. So ask yourself, if I fight for God and you fight against me, who is it that you are fighting for? Respectfully and peacefully, a servant of justice, Tanawah Downing. So we were supposed to be a government of laws. We were always supposed to be a government of laws. Those laws were supposed to derive from the Constitution of the United States. That was our foundation. And the further we get away from the Constitution, the more chaos our country sees and feels. And like I said, the only thing that makes America America is American law. So when you look at legal realism, you know, all through history, the law has been, it's exposed the political nature of these legal rules, and it's portrayed the law, first and foremost, as an instrument of oppression against the disenfranchised. You know, people don't like the law. They have a problem with it, but it's not the law that's the issue. It's the application of the law improperly or unequally among the people, and that's done by a ruler. That's done by someone in a position of power. And we've got to have people in place, certainly judges in place, that recognize that it's very important for our nation to sustain itself and to progress and progress. And the way that we do that is by adhering to our laws. Chief Justice Day, he said that nothing destroys the country quicker than failure to obey their own laws. And I think that says it all, that, you know, our nation, we're not following the Constitution of the United States. We're not following the supreme law of land. We're following these judicial rulings, and we're allowing these judges to change our Constitution. We know that we have the freedom to speak, and that government cannot interfere or obstruct or hinder free speech in order to control the narrative. And yet we're allowing them to do it every single day. You know, and we can't do that.
I'm sitting here reading the history on you know, John Marshall, and it's like you said earlier, you know, he John Marshall started moving in as a strong advocate for the Federalist Party, you know, and this was coming about during George Washington's terms as president. He was making his moves, you know, in the political arena, and as you described, you know, the Federalists favor a strong national government.
Right.
Right. So how, if this is his mindset, right, he's a Federalist in thought, in theory, then how does that impact his decision on stating that the states have no accountability towards the Bill of Rights, and that the Bill of Rights is only applicable to the federal government and not the states?
Yeah. You know, I'm not gonna speculate that. What I do know is that you can see a change in most of these judges. There comes a point in time when initially they seem to be on the right side, and then at some point in time they change. And I think that there were a lot of people that were bought out. I mean, even Chief Justice John Marshall Harlan, who I have a great amount of respect for. You know, he was the only justice during, you know, that period of time from 1862 to 1884 that sided at all with black individuals or United States citizens, and sided against the business right. You know, but even at the very end, he finally ended up making a decision in the Louisiana case, the one that allowed for state sovereignty. And that was a unanimous decision by the court, and it included Justice John Marshall Harlan. And I think that what he said was that Chisholm versus Georgia was a good decision or a good ruling made at the time. Well, it doesn't change. You don't change sovereignty in the middle. It doesn't happen. So when Chief Justice John Marshall Harlan made the decision to allow for states to have sovereignty in 1895, you know, unfortunately, that was contrary to you know, the fundamentals of federalism as well. And so I don't know with Chief Justice John Marshall. I think that a lot of people, I've read his book. A lot of people think that he made some great decisions, but he made some bad ones as well. And this is a great example of a bad one. You know, to say that the states are not accountable to the Bill of Rights. There's a couple questions, you know, and that is the Bill of Rights part of the Constitution? Well, according to Article 5, it says that proposed amendments, once ratified, become part of the Constitution in all intents and purposes. So, yes, when it was ratified by the people on December 15, 1791, it became part of the Constitution, right? So then the next question is, are the judges bound by anything in the Constitution? Well, yes, they are, because Article 6 says the judges in every state shall be bound thereby anything in the Constitution or laws of any states contrary notwithstanding, okay? And so do judges have the right to be able to do something other than what the Constitution says? Well, no, because their oath is bound to the Constitution, right? So everything everything says that these judges have to follow what's in the Constitution. Even if a state has a law that's contrary, they have to do what the Constitution says. So for the Supreme Court of the United States to come out and say that these judges don't have to follow the Constitution of the United States, well, there's the problem. You know, I mean, they went in and they altered the obligations of the contract. And they said these judges don't have to do it. And we know that any impairment of the obligation contract is unconstitutional because Article 1, Section 10 says so. Congress shall not provide for any contract that impairs the obligation of contracts. When the judges enter into a contract with the people that they will do anything in the Constitution, and they swear an oath to the Constitution of the United States, those state judges are bound by contract and obligated to do, you know, what they promise within that contract. And so when the Supreme Court comes out and says you don't have to do it, that's impairing with the obligation of contracts. It is, in fact, unconstitutional.
So another note here, Marshall's impact on the Supreme Court. At the time, the Supreme Court had little authority relative to the president and Congress. It didn't even have its own building, meeting instead in a vacant committee room at the Capitol. But yeah. Over his 34 years as Chief Justice, Marshall shaped the judicial branch into an equal force in government alongside the president and Congress. As a steadfast Federalist, Marshall also interpreted the U.S. Constitution in a way that expanded the power of the federal government relative to the states. In particular, the court's landmark ruling in McCulloch versus Maryland, which Marshall also wrote, established the idea that the Constitution gave Congress implied powers beyond those specifically enumerated in the document, including the power to create a national bank that could not be taxed by individual states. In Cohen versus Virginia, the court affirmed its own right to review the judgments of the state courts, helping to establish the supremacy of federal over state courts.
Yeah, you know, I like Cohen versus Virginia, and I like McCulloch versus Maryland. I like those rulings, and I think that it's important that we have a strong central government. I mean, we have to have that unifying force, but it can't be partial in one side. Thomas Jefferson he talked about the power of the judiciary, and if it consolidated or if it overstepped its separation of powers and it started doing the actions or the role of other branches of government, then it would become a despotic tyrant that would be worse and more venal than the one in which we separated from. And, you know, so when you have the judicial branch that's making its own laws, it's now legislating from the bench. It's now taking over responsibility of the legislative branch. And and when it's making decisions that determine who gets arrested and who doesn't get arrested or who gets charged or not charged, like they do right now, because, you know, when you come in with the information, it's the judge that looks and says, yep, I believe there's sufficient probable cause. Well, now they've moved into enforcement. It moved into an area that they weren't responsible for, and it's actually under the executive branch. So, you know, we've got the judicial branch that's doing the work of all three branches of government, and then we don't have those separate branches actually stepping up and saying, hey, you don't have the right to do this. You know, the judicial branch can't legislate. They can't create laws. They create rulings. But if the legislative branch allows them to continue to do it, then, hey, they, you know, they'll just continue. And but these lines were put into place to seal, you know, the duties and responsibilities. Remember, it's the checks and balances that were put into place to have three separate but equal branches of government to provide those checks and balances so that we can ensure that tyranny and oppression and these things don't occur.
You know, right. And I think it's important to note there that those three branches of government were supposed to be designed to be each other's watchers, not just to be a specific branch that just goes off and does its own thing and nobody watches that branch. It's not like the executive does their own thing, the judicial does their own thing, and each rely on the other to get it done. All three are supposed to coincide, right? It's all supposed to mesh together to create what the Constitution was trying to bring. I mean, is that correct?
Absolutely it is, yeah. You know, I mean, when I submitted an action item request to the congressman Dan Newhouse, who's my congressman here in Washington State, when I submitted it to them and I was asking them to open up an FBI investigation so that we can deal with this issue that occurred to me, right? And when they came back, the chief of staff, he called me up and he tried to convince me that it's not the legislative branch's responsibility to deal with this issue, right? that that when the judicial branch oversteps the separation of powers and decides to modify or change the Constitution of the United States based upon a ruling, that that's not the legislative branch's responsibility to deal with it. Well, whose responsibility is it? Because it's the legislative branch's responsibility to legislate, to create all laws. The Constitution says all legislative power shall be vested in the Congress of the United States. So when you're a member of the Congress of the United States and someone oversteps, the judicial branch oversteps their separation of powers and decides to do your job, it seems to me reasonable that that should be their responsibility to step up and say, you can't do this because well, who else is going to do it?
Well, that's a logical question. I mean, if the judicial branch steers off course and it's going hard left or hard right, who is there to correct course?
Nobody. And therein lies the problem. See, our system of government is one of the main premises behind it is that the political officers in our government are subject to the people, right? They're subject to the people when they need to be, because who is it that's standing behind the judicial branch and saying and holding them accountable for their actions? They're not subject to the people because they have a lifetime appointment, right? They're not subject to the people. They can do anything that they want, say, make any decision that they want, and they're not accountable to anyone except for their own system. Their own.
And they expect us to comply to that.
Right. And so when you have the justices of the United States, you know, and they're in the position for life, we can't kick them out. They can't do, nothing. We
can't sue them, can't touch them, can't do, we don't even know nothing about these people.
And all of that was put into place by them, you know, by them. So we have a branch of government that is absolutely above everyone else. And so when you talk about the nobility, right? Because remember, the whole sovereignty argument that I have is based upon nobility. You know, if you say you can't bill someone for a crime, you have nobility. And so when you look at the history of nobility, there's a couple things that they do. One is anytime you have a title nobility, you have what's called an honorific. An honorific is a title, and it usually goes before the name. And it's some title that they carry. So sir is a great example of an honorific. But in honorific, they use the actual word and your honor, and they put it before their name, honorable, whatever. I mean, that is an honorific. And so you have these individuals who truly feel as though they're nobility, they're kings, they're above the people. And we can't have any branch of government or any individual within America that's above the people. We've got to get the judicial branch subject to the people, because if they're not subject to the people, then they can do whatever they want. They put whatever rulings they want into place, and they have no recourse whatsoever and no ramifications for these bad decisions that they put into place. You know, so they have to follow the will of the people. That branch of government is essential to ensuring that the morals and practices and desires of the American people are actually followed and put into place.
And my question is like, how in touch are these people? How in touch with our society are these people? They've separated, as you said, that you think, you know, and that was a great point. I never even thought of it that way as your honor and things of that nature. We have to stand before them and give them the utmost respect. And these people are not connected to our society. They live in their own places. They're you'll never see them amongst the people in towns and things of that nature. So these people that are making these decisions that are controlling not our lives, but our children's lives and our children's children's lives, how in touch are they with the people of what is going on in this country? Who do they get their information from?
They don't. I mean, they make their decisions based upon their own desires. Now, this is what bothers me the most is that these decisions that they made, you know, so going back to Barron versus Baltimore, 1833, the United States Supreme Court comes out and says, Bill of Rights doesn't apply. United States citizens are not guaranteed the rights that they gave to themselves and that they guaranteed to themselves through the Constitution of the United States. So they said, forget the Constitution. You know, it doesn't matter. We say what the law is, and we're going to say that criminal defendants don't have the protections of criminal proceedings, have the protections of the Constitution. So that decision was made. And then it wasn't until 1925. Now we passed the 14th Amendment. And once again, the 14th Amendment, the individuals introduced it both into the Congress into the House and into the Senate, both said that this was intended to ensure that those privileges and immunities that are defined within the Constitution and enumerated within the Bill of Rights, it from henceforth applies to states. That's what they said. And so there was no denying that the intended purpose of the 14th Amendment was to ensure that states were bound and accountable to the Constitution of the United States. And that was made by Congress. Now, you know, once again, then 2-3 years later, Chief Justice Waite, he goes around that discussion, goes around the intended purpose of law, and he pulls back in Barron versus Baltimore, and he says once again that the Bill of Rights does not provide a restriction against the states, but only the federal government. So he brought it back in, even though it was technically overruled in 1868, it was brought back in. But then what happens is that it wasn't until 1925 that any of the Bill of Rights, any of them, applied to the states. And it was a case called Gitlow versus New York, and it was the freedom of speech was protected against the interference by the states. Now, you would think that if the Supreme Court comes out and says, oh, well, one of the Bill of Rights enumerated within it applies to as a restriction, then they all should apply, right? I mean, you know, how can you start picking and choosing which ones you want to apply and not apply? But it's egregious to think that from 1776, when we're established, up until 1925, no one had any protections of the Constitution. No one had the protection of freedom of speech. Nobody. You didn't. I mean, all these freedoms that you said, yeah, you didn't have them. None of them.
Well, that's what I'm trying to, I guess I'm just trying to understand like the rationale behind that. If it's only at the federal level, how does that apply to the people? How does that apply to me?
So tell me, what is the federal government, right?
Well, that's because what I'm saying. What the hell is the federal? I know the federal government can put you in prison. I know they can do that.
So I'm a United States citizen. The day that I'm born, I'm a United States citizen, right? Because the 14th Amendment says that all persons born or naturalized in the United States are citizens of the United States and of the state in which they reside. Now, that particular statement is where Chief Justice Waite went and said that once again, that the Bill of Rights does not apply as restriction against the states. And what he was saying, so the dual sovereignty theory, right? This theory that there's two different citizenships that exist. There's a citizenship within the United States of America, and there's a citizenship within the state where in which you reside. That derives from the case Dred Scott versus Sanford, which is what I talked about within the letter that says that blacks are not and were not intended to be included on the word citizen in the Constitution. What Chief Justice Taney did in that decision was he created dual sovereignty and this theory of dual sovereignty where blacks are not citizens of the United States, but they still reside within a state. Therefore, they're a citizen of the state. And he established this dual sovereignty. So you can be a citizen in a state and you can be treated differently than a citizen of the United States because your rights don't convey to you wherever you choose to reside. You're only given whatever rights the state allows and provides for you. But that is going back to, once again, the Confederacy, right? Because if you're saying that, and this is the big thing that I brought up, is that if state courts have the ability to deprive me of a right that's secured by the Constitution of the United States, then whose court is more powerful? The state court. Because the federal court, the United States Supreme Court, has to follow the Constitution. So if the state court is able to deprive me of rights that the Supreme Court of the United States has to follow, then that means that the state courts are now more powerful than the Supreme Court. And more importantly, how can the Supreme Court adjudicator review a case in which the procedures and practices that they have to follow are not being followed? The whole point of the Constitution was to bond everybody together, was to bind them into a practice that applied equally among everyone. So we had equal rights and equal laws for and treatment of all people.
Well, I guess that's what I'm trying to process, Tanawah, because what I'm hearing you say is, according to this ruling, right, Barron versus Baltimore, trying to bring it to today's, you know, climate, is that according to some states, my freedom of speech is not protected?
If it's not specifically enumerated within the state constitution, you are not entitled to it. That is what's been espoused.
And you're saying now, that the state of Washington does not recognize the Fifth Amendment, I believe it was. Isn't that what you said?
Yes. Yeah. So the grand jury is clause one of Amendment 5. When I submitted this writ of habeas corpus in the written allegation against the state specifically said their response to it was the Fifth Amendment doesn't apply to the state of Washington.
And that's because of Barron versus Baltimore.
That derives from Barron versus Baltimore. Yeah. Because when Chief Justice Waite came in and said, brought in once again, the dual sovereignty theory, the theory that you can be a citizen of a state, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to get the rights of the federal government. I'm a United States citizen, no matter where within the jurisdiction of the United States I choose to reside. I'm entitled to those by my birthright, no matter where I'm at, right? So when a state says, I'm not going to do it, and the federal government says, okay, you don't have to do it, then the Constitution has no meaning. It has no bearing, it has no purpose.
Well, that's, so when is the American citizen under the federal government? Like, when is the American citizen protected by the federal rights?
Whenever you're in Washington, D.C.
That's it, just the area of D.C.
Because that's the only federal land that there is. We, people exist in the physical realm, right? Law exists in the spiritual realm, right? Law doesn't cover the land. So when we exist within a spiritual realm, then where, or in a physical realm, that's within the state, because the states are the only physical element of the nation other than the District of Columbia. District of Columbia follows federal laws, right? And it's the only place. So when you're within the District of Columbia, yeah, you're free. I mean, that's why all these people, all these lawmakers are able to do the things that they're doing and get away with it, because United States citizens are supposed to be governed only by the laws of the United States. When we come into a state, you know, the state of Washington, I'm not bound to the state of Washington laws because I'm a United States citizen. I'm free. Therefore, the only laws that I care about, because the only laws that I'm bound to, are the laws of the United States. That's it. So,
well, that's what makes sense to me.
I don't need to know all these laws that the state of Washington creates, because they don't apply to me. They don't apply to me until I change my legal relationship with the state. And you do that through a guilty conviction. You do that through adoption. You do that through marriage. You do that through any number of different things. You change your legal relationship with the state, and now you become bound and accountable to the state and to state laws. But we're not meant to be that way. I'm a United States citizen. No matter where within the jurisdictional United States I choose to reside, Washington is no different than California. It's all part of America. And if America has American laws, and that's what makes it America, then you know what? Those laws apply no matter where I'm at, no matter what I'm doing, because that court here in Washington State is subject to the United States Supreme Court.
Well, you would think at least the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments, you know what I mean? You would think that the Bill of Rights was the paramount to any state constitution. And you would think that the state constitution only had to deal with, like you say, your living quarters, what you need from the state. You know what I mean? That is separate from the federal government.
Right. That's why I say that the way that the system was designed to work was that the laws that affect the people were supposed to come from the federal government, right? From the central government. They were to come together as a representative government, and they were to determine, you know, what would be a crime and not a crime. So that, and then they would federate them out to each one of the regional governments for administration, right? So that way, murder would be murder no matter where within the jurisdiction of the United States you choose to reside. It would be the same accountability or the same crime. And so that was the way it was supposed to work. And then the states were to have laws, but those laws were for administrative purposes to implement. And in doing so, what would happen then is the central government would be the accuser, right? So the United States of America would be your accuser, not the state. And the state would then be able to act as a neutral judge, right? Because they don't have any interest in it. But when the state creates their own laws, their own criminal laws, then guess what? That judge works for the plaintiff, right? That's where the conflict of interest occurs, is that the states are creating their own laws and then getting the people subject to those laws. And now we have unequal treatment of people. You know, that's why in Florida right now, I can go down there and I can go without a mask. I can go without my vax. But here in Oregon, you can't. You'll get arrested for it. Or New York, you'll get arrested. We were not supposed to have that separate treatment of people. You know, if we're going to have equality and all people treat equally, we've got to have one set of laws that treat them equally. And so that's what it was talking about in the letter remaining the case. It says that the role of government is to govern, but that role to govern must be fair. Government ceases to govern when it chooses to take sides. It's no longer governing, but rather ruling. So when government chooses to take a side in a case, they're now creating rules. They're now ruling and not governing. The whole point of government was to govern, but that governing must be fair. It has to be. The reason why the United States citizens are entitled to fair and equal governing in the same way that they're entitled to equal protection of the laws is because if government is the one administering those laws, then equal governing is an attribute of that. In order to have equal laws, you have to have equal governing, because the government is in fact the one administering those laws. So you're entitled to fair and equal governing in the same way that you're entitled to equal protection of laws, because otherwise you wouldn't have equal laws.
Because because of this, I can I can see with a little bit more clarity as to how an individual can be charged with a state crime and a federal crime, even though that it's the same crime, and be charged from two different entities and sentenced under those two different entities. But yet, however, when it comes to our rights, we're not protected, you know, by that federal government. It's mind blowing to me to, because I'm sitting there trying to process this.
So there's two things, right? There's two different judicial functions here. One is at the state, one is at the federal government. The federal government was not supposed to have its own justice system, right?
Right.
Article 3 specifically states the trial of all crimes, with the exception of impeachment, shall be by jury, and the trial shall occur in the state in which the crime is said to have been committed. Nowhere in that does it say anything about the establishment of a federal government or a federal justice system, right? It specifically states the state. And so, you know, obviously the founders' intended purpose was for the states to adjudicate the crimes. And that's why Article 3 says that in all cases which a state shall be party, the Supreme Court shall have original jurisdiction, because the intended purpose was for the states to be neutral and unbiased. The central government would create the laws, they'll federate them out, and then the judge would be the state, and the state would then be able to investigate, not take a side because they don't have any interest in it, right? But, however, if the federal government became a party in the cause, then you would need a neutral, unbiased third party, which in that case would be the states. You know, so the state is supposed to be the judge whenever the federal government has a claim against you. But if the state chooses to have a claim against you, then the federal government becomes the neutral, unbiased third party. This United States Supreme Court. It couldn't be the district courts, because the district court judges were elevated or raised right out of the states. You know, so they would have still had preferences or biases toward state interests and state laws. So the only court that the framers felt would be able to be neutral and unbiased at the federal level would be the United States Supreme Court, because they're elevated into a position where they're no longer accountable to states. So it was never, never, never supposed to be states taking a party in the cause. They were never supposed to have their own laws, because if they did, then guess what? The federal government becomes a neutral and biased third party. It doesn't function that way, but that's the intended purpose. And so, you know, you can't have a crime committed and then with the state, and then you pay your debt back for that crime or that alleged crime, and then have to go and pay it again without violating double jeopardy. How can the federal government come in and charge you for the same offense that you've already paid your debt for, right? It doesn't work that way.
Or come in and pick up a charge that the state doesn't have the evidence to, you know what I mean, to process. The state turns over charges to the federal government all the time when they don't have the evidence or the resources to process this.
When Article 6 says this Constitution and the laws of the United States shall be the supreme law of land, right? That means that they enjoy legal superiority over conflicting provisions with state constitutions or laws, right?
Exactly.
We have the federal laws that were created and by the representative government, and those apply to every single person across the United States. So when the states come in and say, well, we're going to do something different, right? You've got that unequal application. If a state can't prosecute because there's insufficient evidence, that doesn't give the federal government the right to come in. Otherwise, the state should be using the federal laws to prosecute. I mean, those are the laws that they're bound by.
So
all laws are supposed to...
And wrapping this up, T, right, because this is a lot of information, right, and there's no question that you know this, but for like me and my listeners and things that this is very overwhelming and to process, how can we just break down how Barron versus Baltimore is affecting our everyday lives today?
Every day we have rights that are deprived of us based upon rulings, and we can go through these rulings and we can look at the origin of them. You know, when you talk about the freedom of speech, that was Gitlo versus New York, right? But if the states are still looking at the base fundamental ruling, and that fundamental ruling says that you don't have this entitlement, the states are using those as a mechanism to deprive you of a right to keep themselves from being accountable. So it goes to the fruit of the poisonous tree doctrine, which is that if the root is bad or the foundation is bad, then obviously, you know, all the fruit that drives from it will also be bad. So if the foundation is unconstitutional, then obviously all the fruit that drives from it would also be unconstitutional, because they're tainted by the illegality of the way in which they were obtained. Okay. So when we have Barron versus Baltimore that's in place, or Dred Scott versus Sanford that's in place, that create two different major issues, right? Dred Scott versus Sanford created what's called tyranny. So tyranny is the unequal application of laws by a ruler, by someone in a position of power. So when a judge makes a decision to deprive individuals of rights, that would be a tyrant. He would be acting in tyranny. Oppression, in contrast, is the unequal application of a law. So when a law creates unequal treatment of people, then that would be oppression. Government would be oppressing. So those two rulings are the foundation of most all of this tyranny oppression that we see across the United States, because it allows for the tyrants, the judges, to act as tyrants and to apply the law unequally based upon their own social, political, or public policy. They can pick and choose. But then you have the ability to create laws that are unconstitutional. You have the ability for a state to create a law that says, I'm going to deprive United States citizens residing within my borders or within the state's borders the rights that are secured by the Constitution of the United States, and able to do it based upon this root, the root being Barron versus Baltimore. So until we go back and we remove from and we stricken from the record those foundational issues, because if you're building a house and the foundation is bad, do you just repair it? The foundation, do you just keep building? No, the house is going to fall apart if you don't go back and fix the problem at the foundation. Mm-hmm. And that's where we're at right now, is that we have cracks in our foundation. It goes back to 1833. It was there, it was put into place, and all we're doing right now is putting a Band-Aid on it. But that Band-Aid is only temporary. Every single time a case comes up, all they do is put another Band-Aid on it, another band. We got to fix the foundation. And unfortunately, when we go and fix the foundation, we have to do that with the understanding that we have to let everything, all the chips fall where they will. Because once you remove the foundation, right, the flawed foundation, it's going to affect a whole bunch of cases behind it called progeny. That's the reason why this has never been addressed. So in 1925, that was when the very first right was secured and protected against interference by the states in the case Gitlow versus New York, right? So that same year, Congress came out with the Judicial Reform Act of 1925. That Judicial Reform Act, what it did was it gave the United States Supreme Court and all state courts, Supreme Courts, the ability to be a court of discretion, all right? Why did they do that? They did that because they found out that for the last 120 years, we haven't been given United States citizens the rights that are secured by the Constitution of the United States. And the Congress said, that's a pretty big deal. So what we're going to do is we're going to make the court a court of discretion now, because then they can pick and choose what cases they want to hear or not hear, so that they don't have to listen to these cases. So they don't have to hear these cases that will affect them because it's just too big of a deal. That's what they did. That's what they did. There's no denying that. They came out and they made that court a court of discretion. Now, that particular act, right, because remember, acts of Congress must comply with the Constitution of the United States. If there's an obligation that's established by the Constitution, then even Congress can't go and change it, right? So that law is only legitimate and lawful and constitutional so far as it does not impair the obligations of the Constitution. So when the Constitution identifies in Article 3 a specific duty that says that the Supreme Court has original jurisdiction anytime the state is named a party, guess what? That is an obligation established by the Constitution. Therefore, that the Judicial Reform Act cannot violate it. So the United States Supreme Court can be a court of discretion so far as the state is not a party in the cause. The moment the state becomes a party in cause, that court does not have the right to be discretion. They have to hear those cases because that's an obligation created by the Constitution imposed upon them. And Congress can't impair that. So when we go to the Supreme Court of the United States, guess what? Today, we do not have a right to have our case heard by the Supreme Court. We should, right? Every one of us should have our cases be able to heard by the highest court in the land. But they pick and choose. They say, no, we're not going to see this case. We're not going to see that case. They use discretion to be able to pick and choose what case they want to hear.
Right.
Every single one of us have the right to have that court hear our cases, right? And right always drives from another's duty to act. They have the duty, therefore we have the right. So when we go to them and we say, I want you to hear my case because something occurred within it, it was wrong, and they deny us that, and they say, we're not going to hear it, guess what? That's a breach of duty. And when you have the breach of duty, it results in the violation of the rights. Remember, we all receive civil rights as a result of accepting the obligation to protect the rights of others. Every single one of us today have the right to take our cases to the United States Supreme Court, and they have a duty to hear those cases. And if they choose not to, through discretion or whatever, that's the violation of the duty or the breach of duty, which results in our violation of our rights. So we need to remember that. But, you know, I like something that Marshall said, and I don't remember which case this came from. I think it was McCulloch versus Maryland. But he said that the power of government is defined and limited And those limits may not be mistaken or forgotten because the Constitution is written. To what purpose are powers limited? And to what purpose is that limitation committed to writing if those limits may at any time be passed by those intended to be restrained? The difference between a government with limited powers and unlimited powers is abolished if those limits do not confine the person on whom they are imposed, and if acts prohibited and acts allowed are of equal obligation. It is a proposition too plain to be contested that the Constitution controls any acts, statutes, customs, or rulings repugnant to it, or that the judiciary may alter the Constitution by a simple ruling made by a group of judges intent upon the advancement of an industry and not upon the will of the people. By the way, that last little bit was written by me. The judiciary does not have a right to change that. If it's in a written form, everyone must obey it, including those that are ruling over us.
Absolutely. There's no question.
You know, like I said, the law has always been portrayed as a weapon of oppression. It's always been abused by those in position of power because that's what they do. That's what happens when they get into power. And so as a United States citizen, no matter where I reside within the United States, I'm entitled to those rights secured by and enumerated in the Constitution of the United States. That is the truth. And that is for every single one of us. And no one can take away, no one can change that. If we walk into the Supreme Court tomorrow and we say, I'm entitled to Clause 1 of Amendment 5, I'm entitled to grand jury, I'm entitled to be present during that accusation, I'm entitled to hear those accusations against me and to counter them, then guess what? What can they say? They can come up with 20-page argument of rubbish, but we can say it once again. This is what the Constitution says. No person shall be held to answer for a capital or otherwise infamous crime unless on the presentment or indictment of a grand jury.
Amen.
That's clear. We can say that 100 times, and there is no lie that can penetrate that. No person shall be held to answer for a capital or otherwise infamous crime unless on the presentment or indictment of a grand jury. We can speak those words, and no one can counter it. They can come up with any lie that they want, but that does not change those words.
Right.
And that's what we need to remember, is that what is it that we believe in? Well, the strongest bond that holds our nation together is the faith in the laws between us. That's what we need to believe in. We need to believe in those laws because those laws are the truth. And if it says it right in there, you know, when you're looking at contract law, the easiest and quickest way to determine whether or not there's a breach in contract is what's called the four corners test. Show me where in the four corners of this document it says that I'm not entitled to an indictment by a grand jury. I'll show you where it says I am entitled to it. They won't be able to show me where I'm not entitled to it. Therefore, it's not consistent with the contract. Every one of us knows that if you have a contract and you don't write within it so the specifics that are required or expected, you're not going to win. You're not going to win the argument. You got to detail. It's got to be written. And I'll tell you what, it is written that says that I am entitled to it. It's not written that says that I'm not entitled to it. That's a breach of contract.
And final question. How would you see today's panel ruling on that decision? Today's justices.
I think that if we get into that courtroom